Hello everybody, my name is Rosaria Puglisi and I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to this nice conference. The title of my presentation is Advanced Optic Techniques for Nanostructured Solar Cells, and I will show you our results on the synthesis of silicon nanostructures, the development of a solution-based doping technique for fabricating metallurgical junctions, and the integration of this process inside solar cell devices. About the institute for which I work, which is the Institute for Microelectronics and Microsystems. IMM is one of the largest research institutes of National Research Council in Italy. It is organized in five different sites. The headquarters are in Catania, where I work, and we have other research units in Milan, Bologna, Rome, Lecce, and Catania. In the next slide, I will show you a video presenting our institute.
IMM Mila dall'aggregazione di diversi istituti del CNR. Oggi è uno degli istituti più grandi del Dipartimento Scienze Fisiche, con uno staff permanente di 200 ricercatori, tecnologi, tecnici e amministrativi.
Nei nostri laboratori avanzati ci occupiamo di microelettronica, fabbrichiamo cioè materiali e dispositivi piccoli fino ad un milionesimo di metro. Qui l'operatore indossa tute speciali per proteggere i nanomateriali dalle contaminazioni. I campioni vengono poi osservati e analizzati con attrezzature sofisticate per conoscerne le proprietà fisiche e chimiche. Come passo successivo ci occupiamo di modellizzare e fabbricare micro e nanodispositivi per l'ambiente, la biomedicina, lo spazio e i trasporti. Il nostro istituto è anche impegnato in attività di divulgazione e di formazione dei giovani durante i loro percorsi di tesi di laurea e di dottorato.
I would like also to thank my former students and current students. Thanks to their work, I'm presenting you this seminar today, and also my colleague at IMM in Catania and the university with which I collaborate, and the funding through this national project. In this slide, I'm showing you the results about the characterization of silicon nanowires, which we have fabricated by using the well-known vapor liquid solid method, which consists in using metallic nanodots as catalysts to induce the nucleation and the formation of silicon nanowires in correspondence of the presence of the silicon of the metallic quantum dots. And the silicon nanowires are imaged here in this scanning electron microscopy in cross view, and as you can see, these are the silicon nanowires still presenting the metallic catalyst on top. This is a high resolution TM microscopy showing one silicon nanowire. They present a flat surface and a crystalline structure, and we observe them by electron energy loss spectroscopy coupled in situ with the TEM. We can observe the different chemical phases present in the silicon nanowires together with metallic dots. This is a high resolution TEM microscopy showing one of the smallest silicon nanowires we have been able to grow. Its diameter is 2.8 nanometer, and this is a recognized technological challenge. These small silicon nanowires present very interesting physical properties and many applications, technological applications. One of their application is in the solar cell field, when we integrate the silicon nanowires on the top of the solar cell, so in the emitter region, where the device faces the solar irradiation, they act as an efficient, a very efficient trapping light trapping layer. So we increase the number of photo generated electrical carriers with respect to a flat silicon standard solar cell, and then we increase the short circuit current density power device. Now, when we want to use silicon nanowires and the emitter of a solar cell, we have to face a very important process step, which is creating the metallurgical junction. This is a very important part of our device because it creates the necessary electric field, which will help us separate the photocarriers and transport them to our metallic contacts to increase the cell efficiency. When we have to create this metallurgical junction in the presence of silicon nanostructures, we cannot use the standard doping techniques because they have a list of limitations, like the inability to achieve a group test down to the nanometer range of the doping profile, the absence or a difficult conformality, which is the property to essentially dope a structure, a three-dimensional structure of our wafer, if present on our wafer, the stochastic spatial distribution of the dopant atoms, and the crystal damage critical for nanostructured surfaces, which is only partially recovered by the standard thermal annealing processes. Moreover, we have to use, in case of standard technique, expensive and dangerous materials and equipment. So in 2008, a solution-based approach called monolayer doping or molecular doping has been proposed. It consists in cleaning the silicon surface by the SiO2, native SiO2 presence, and then deep coat the sample inside solution of the dopant containing molecules. In the case we use phosphorus containing molecules, we can perform an N-type doping of our silicon. We can cover the molecular layer with an SiO2 cap layer, and then we anneal the sample to break the molecules and release the dopant atoms inside the silicon, which will diffuse inside the substrate matrix with the diffusion characteristics. Process. Now, if you want to dope the silicon with phosphorus, you can use this molecule, which is the DAT1 propyl phosphonate. But you can also find a similar molecule to perform boron doping, so P-type. And this molecule is the allyl boronic acid bilalkyl ester, which is depicted. This graph represents the spreading resistance profile measurements for two samples which have been annealed at 950 and 1000 degrees C. And this is the carrier concentration as a function of the depth for the two samples. And as you can see, the peak of the carrier concentration reaches values of 10 to the 19 per cubic centimeter, and the junction depth reaches values as small as 20 nanometer. We have also demonstrated smaller junction depths as like 10 nanometers. These are the similar results for phosphorus-type doping. And again, as you can see, we can modulate the junction properties by changing any temperatures and having characteristics always reaching high levels of peak concentrations. Now we have, as you can understand, the electrical properties strongly depend on the way we deposit the molecule over the surface. It is known that the molecule forms a self-assembled monolayer on top of silicon, and their packing density helps in predetermine the surface density of the dopant atoms we deposit on the silicon. But little is known in literature regarding the possible presence of the multiple layers of molecules on the top of the first one. So we have followed this formation and this mechanism, and we have recently published the results, and we have observed that after forming a full compact monolayer of molecules on top of silicon, we start deposit other layers of molecules. We have followed this formation by using high resolution microscopy analysis. And after a certain point, we have also followed the deformation, the surface coverage as a function of the deposition time, also for the second layer. Now, after cleaning the samples, we have observed that the molecular coverage decreases and this becomes more evident at long deposition times. We have also performed the FT calculations of the first layer of molecules on silicon and the second layer of the first one, and we have observed that the first layer bond, chemically bond with the silicon substrate to phosphorus, this is the first molecular layer, through the phosphorus oxygen silicon bonds, and the molecules bond between each other through phosphorus oxygen phosphorus bonds. Moreover, we have observed that the second layer of molecules, which is represented by this molecule here, bond to the first layer of molecule through weak forces like nanobulls. As I said, we applied the molecular doping to silicon nanowire array, and we have observed that the molecules just deposited over the silicon nanowire by using an electron energy loss spectroscopy coupled in situ with a transmission electron microscope, and we have followed, we have observed the chemical species at high resolution, high energy and spatial resolution. So we have identified over the silicon nanowire, the molecules have been deposited of silicon over silicon nanowires. And the blue region, this is a RGB reconstructed image of our analysis, and the blue region represents the silicon nanowire material covered with the oxygen atoms. This is the oxygen essentially signal, and over the oxygen signal we revealed a carbon signal. These structures represent agglomerates of carbon, and due to the size, we attribute these agglomerated structures to the single molecules. And this is the first time that these molecules have been directly observed by high resolution methods. We have also performed simulations of these systems, and we have seen that the molecule essentially bonds to the silicon substrate through the oxygen atoms and is perfectly matched with the profile observed experimentally. These are, in this slide, I'm summarizing the results of the integration process inside solar cells. And this is an image of a typical device. We have reached source secret current densities as high as 9.3 milliamps per square centimeter. And we attribute that result to the fact that the silicon nanowires have an efficient light coupling, but still we have observed a strong parasitic resistance effects due to the fact that the metallic contact, which is a finger bus geometry, is not optimized for a nanostructure at emitter, and moreover, for the fact that we did not process our samples with passivation processes. Now, one of the limitations of molecular doping, which has been raised recently in literature, is due to the fact that the molecule, together with the dopant atoms, also contains carbon atoms. And carbons, for certain device applications, for certain technologies, can create, can affect the electrical performance of the final device. Indeed, interstitial carbon can bond with the substitution of the phosphorus atoms, forming pairs which have in turn form multiple deep energy levels that contribute to the phosphorus deactivation. So CNRIMM has patented the idea to use phosphoric acid as a source for doping the silicon. Phosphoric acid is well known, has many advantages. The first one is that it is very well known inside the semiconductor industry because it is used for removal of the silicon nitride, which is a very typical material inside the semiconductor fabs. And it is it has also a high selectivity respect to silicon, but it has also very important advantages in terms of the fact that it is small. It does not contain carbon. It has a smaller footprint, which means that we can pack higher density of molecules over the silicon surface, and as a consequence, we have a higher dopant source, starting source on our substrate. Moreover, the ratio between the phosphorus and the rest of atoms is more favorable in the case of the phosphoric acid with respect to the standard molecules used in molecular doping. These are the results, the electrical results of our approach, of our proposed approach. These are obtained by using the phosphoric acid over silicon. And as you can see, we have reached a dose of electrical active carriers as high as 6.5 times 10 to the 15 per square centimeter, and the peak is as high as 1 times 10 to the 20 per cubic centimeter. And even after cleaning, the dose and the sheet resistance show very, very important results. I would like, before concluding, to advertise a special issue which I've been, I'm guest editing together with my colleagues for the journal Micro from MDPI, and I would like to invite you all to contribute to this special issue. And I would like to conclude by saying that we present the results on a simple, efficient, and inexpensive way to dope semiconductor, and we have followed the formation of the first monolayer and of the second monolayer, and we have monitored this formation in terms of the surface coverage. And we have also understood the mechanisms of bonding between the molecules and the silicon substrate, and between the molecules and the other molecules. And we have also presented the results of a carbon-free, eco-friendly, and reliable method to dope silicon by using a molecule which does not contain any carbon. So the total approach is carbon-free, and the results are very, very interesting. And another advantage, very important, of this molecule is that it is very less harmful than the previous ones, because phosphoric acid is present in many foods. It is used to increase the tangy taste of soda drinks, as well as used in many other foods as a preservative. And as a last result, I would like to remind that we have successfully integrated the molecular doping in nanostructured silicon solar cells. I would like to thank you for your attention and for listening to me, and bye.